spirits received your sympathetic vibrations and are beginning to materialize. They've assembled for a swinging wake. And what's a wake without a little music? At the very end of the ballroom, there is a man playing a pipe organ, giving the scene an appropriately macabre score. But who is this mysterious ghost? Lean back in your doom buggy and we will find that out together. So, out of all the instruments in the world, why is the pipe organ the one connected with dark things? Well, think about it. If you hear pipe organs, where are you usually at? Probably a church. Probably during some special ceremony. Like a baptism, or a wedding, or a funeral. That might be part of the association. Also, the organ is loud and bombastic, which doesn't really lend itself to something nice and calming and cheery. Heck, the most famous organ piece of all time, Bach's Toccata and Fugue, is the most cliche soundtrack choice for the dark and sinister. Not to mention, think about all the movies that score a villain's theme with an organ, or straight up make them an organ. There's a lot more to it than that. If you want to see a really good analysis on why, I highly recommend checking out Sideways' video on the subject. But basically, because of all those dark connotations, it's perfect for a haunted house ride. The idea of a phantom organist goes back to the early drafts by Ken Anderson. Specifically, this piece. Disembodied footprints lead to a pump organ, seemingly playing itself. Other Imagineers play around with the idea, including Mark Davis, Claude Coates, and Ezio Tensio. Rolly Crump went with a more fantastical organ, with more gothic details. A model of this was used to show off the ghost effect in an episode of Disneyland. But which one of these would be the model for which the ballroom's organ would be made? None of them. Let's rewind a couple years. In the 1950s, a man in Los Angeles was selling an old organ console. That's the part with the keys and the pedals and all that jazz. It had been used during the silent era for someone to play in the theater. However, it didn't work anymore and he wanted to get rid of it. Harper Goff saw the classify ad and bought it off him for $50. With a bit of sprucing up and a new set of pipes, it would be utilized in one of the best Disney films ever made, 1954's 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. This was Captain Nemo's organ, residing in his quarters on the Nautilus. While he was a scientific man living off of what the sea gave to him, he had a taste for the finer things in life, like classical music.
And until I make up my mind, you should find ample diversion. Here you have literature, art treasures, my collections, and even music, if you so desire.
The organ is used in one of the best scenes in the film. Nemo's about to sink a ship of ammunition coming out of a colony island, one that he used to be enslaved at, run by a country that killed and tortured his family. Before he does it, he plays the Toccata and Fugue. Is it to drown out the trauma of what he went through? Or to help distract himself from the cruelty he is about to enact on others? Sorry for that little tangent, I just look for any excuse I have to gush about 20,000 Leagues. Anyways, after the film was released, the organ was displayed in an exhibit in Tomorrowland, until it closed in 1966. Eventually, someone got the idea to repurpose the organ for the Haunted Mansion. They replaced the pipes, removed the mirror, added a little bat music stand, and put it in the ballroom. Though it should be noted that only Disneyland's organ is the authentic prop. The rest are just replicas. That's all well and good, but this series is the furniture of the Haunted Mansion. What about the organist? If you look back at all of the old concept art, you'll notice a similar theme. You don't see the organist. They're all shadows. This could have inspired the phantom piano player located in other mansions, but we're not talking about him. What made them shift to a more materialized organist? Maybe because of the Pepper's Ghost effect. It's more visible from the balcony than the shadow, and it's a more impressive effect. It was Mark Davis who gave us the organist we're familiar with the long coat and top hat. This ended up being the design that stuck, and that was the one put into the mansion. We encounter the organist in the ballroom. While the rest of the ghosts party and waltz, he is focused on the music. The chaotic, off-key, and off-tempo music. While he plays, little banshees emerge from the pipes. The ballroom is a huge set piece, and the organist is only a small part of it. But he's still one of the most memorable characters if, for nothing else, just the music. William Sobranski was the man who performed the kooky organ you hear in the ballroom. He had done a lot of organ performances in Hollywood dating back to the 1920s. He was given Buddy Baker soon and just did whatever the hell he wanted with it, improvising and making each take progressively weirder. Hitting wrong notes, doing weird rhythms, finishing on dissonant chords. It really drives home the chaotic mood of the scene. There are ghosts swinging from chandeliers, one of them is lying underneath the table, and, most scandalous of all, the women are leading the men! So, who is this organist fellow? He's one of the characters that's had a few different identifications over the years. Yeah, there's a lot of that in the show. The SLG comics had a story about him in the canceled 8th edition. Luckily, we can just read it on the internet. He was a composer looking for a choir. So he killed a school bus of children to get them. I can't possibly imagine why this story never stuck. At the Magic Kingdom, there's a crypt for a composer located in the interactive queue, which I brought up in previous episodes. If you hit the keys or the instruments on the side, it plays music. The crypt belongs to someone called Ravenscroft, named for Thurl Ravenscroft for those of you who pay attention to these sorts of things. But there are no epitaphs or anything else indicating his story. However, there is another identification, one that's actually stuck. The organist was one of the characters you encountered in the Ghost Post via the Phantom Radio. He was called Victor Geist. He's one of the characters who assists the player in helping ghosts leave and enter the mansion. He's a pretty nice guy, if a little eccentric and absent-minded. In a little interview with the Grim Gazette, he keeps accidentally giving information away and insisting that the interviewer is pulling shit out of the air. He's also pretty close with Sally Slater, the tightrope girl. Victor was further developed with the host of Ghost Jars that were released alongside the 50th anniversary. The labels had a little poem about him and a neon picture inside. He was a musical prodigy who could play any instrument in any song. And he never stops playing, always chugging along in the ballroom. So that kind of furthers the absent-minded genius thing that the Ghost Post was going with. Any other appearances to consider? He was an NPC in the video game. He's grumpy and cold towards Zeke, the player character, but softens a bit once you've exorcised the bad spirits in the ballroom. Ezra's getup during the wedding scene from the film, while he was playing the organ no less, is an obvious illusion. According to some of what I've read, I think he was supposed to be a standalone character at one point, but he must have gotten left on the cutting room floor. He has a blink and you'll miss it cameo in the Marvel comic, where he's under the captain's curse with the rest of the ballroom ghosts. Mystic Manor contains a possible homage to him in the music room, where a grand piano and a calliope play the attraction's main theme. In the recent comic by IDW, he had a minor role, showing up when Sydney gives him suggestions on how to be scarier. And, for those of you wondering about Phantom Manor, their organist is a completely different character. No resemblance to the mansions whatsoever. So he's barely worth bringing up. I am running out of ways to wrap up these videos, so please lean back in your dune buggy and we will proceed in the next video. Thanks for watching.